Welcome to another episode of the Tinman Podcast. I'm your host, Chris Phineas. Before we begin, I want to tell you about my friends at DashClip, products producing optimism. DashClip is the most efficient, quick-access, slim wallet that will make you feel better every time you use it. Every wallet sold will help support mental health, combating anxiety and depression. A daily reminder to live your Dash happier. You can check them out at thedashclip.com. Now here we go. This is an exciting time of year for sports fans, college football fans especially. With conference championship games complete and the college football playoff on the horizon, one thing that shouldn't get lost in the shuffle is one of the oldest and deepest rivalries in all of sport, Army versus Navy. The United States Military Academy and the United States Naval Academy have been competing on the gridiron for over 130 years. The first meeting occurred in 1890, and this year will be the 124th overall. Navy leads the series with 62 wins, 54 losses, and 7 ties, thanks in large part to a long winning streak in the early 2000s. But Army has won 4 of the last 6, including last year. As remarkable as the pageantry and rivalry is on the field, the mutual respect and what the participants represent should be most admired. In one broadcast several years ago, Gary Danielson commented that competing in the pressure-packed game is the easiest thing the players from both academies do all week. In this episode, you'll hear from three people with unique perspectives on this special game. Two of them were on the field as significant pieces for their teams, Trent Steelman for Army and Jamale Carothers for Navy. The third, Tricia Brandenburg, is one of the people behind the scenes that helps make the game happen. If you want to skip through the different interviews, you can find the timestamps in the episode notes, along with some links to learn more. I would also highly recommend checking this one out on YouTube for some cool pictures and extras on the video version. We start with Trent Steelman. Steelman played quarterback for Army from 2009 to 2012. He was the first freshman in the modern era to start the game under center for the Black Knights against the Midshipmen. Army has been playing football for 133 years, and Steelman's name can be found all over their record books. Trent was a respected leader amongst a team of future leaders, and he took a few minutes to give us his perspective. I'd like to welcome Trent Steelman to the Tin Man Podcast. Trent was a quarterback for Army from 2009 to 2012 and really left his mark on the program as a whole, but also on the Army-Navy game in particular. So Trent, thank you for taking the time to join me and giving us a few minutes to share some of your experiences.
No, Chris, thank you for having me. It's awesome always getting back on environments like this and being able to reminisce on the old times. So I enjoy it. I appreciate you having me.
Yeah, you know, if you would, maybe just start by sharing with us a little bit of your path getting to West Point in the first place. For our listeners who may or may not know, our families know each other going back to both growing up in Bowling Green, Kentucky. And
yeah.
Both of our moms played a lot of tennis, and I played some sports with your older brother, Tanner, and then you played some with my younger brother, Casey. So we've gone back a long way, and I kind of got the pleasure of witnessing your progression, but kind of tell the listeners your path and how your journey took you to West Point in the first place.
Yeah, well, a progression it was, there is no doubt, because obviously you guys know me better than the average human and can probably attest to the wild kid I was, and then learning the hard way about leadership and developing and becoming a man. And obviously West Point did a lot of that for me, and just that environment and being able to obviously just be indoctrinated to that type of culture over the course of my 4 years, really 5 years there, including the prep school. It was a life changer. And to be honest with you, just how I got there was a little unorthodox in itself. And in my opinion, God's timing and really what he wanted for me in my life. And so get through 3 years of starting at Bowling Green High School as a quarterback. Surrounded by talent, we've had, you know, numerous wins, numerous state championship appearances up until that point in my high school career, and football was always what I wanted to do. It was the game I loved. While obviously I played other sports along the way and throughout high school, in my mind it was football or nothing, just because of my pure passion and love for the sport. And deep down inside, I believe I had what it took to succeed at that level. And so get to really March of my senior year in 2008, and I have no offers. And so ironically, all the academies that come in at the beginning of my senior year, just requesting to see if I was even interested in that path. And really at that point, I wasn't, and just not really knowing and kind of taking the name for face value. It was just not something I was really wanted to do with my life at that point. But lo and behold, 6 months later, probably a month after signing day, get an offer from Army, and I literally commit on the spot. All I saw was D1 football, an opportunity to go play, an opportunity to go to do what I love, and I jumped on it. So I committed to them without ever stepping on campus up until this point. The first time I had walked on West Point's campus was for their spring game, which was in April. So it was a pretty, and in the meantime, just the logistics and the procedures to get even accepted in that short time period was a miracle in itself. But lo and behold, the journey starts, started at the prep school, actually, which was in Fort Monmouth, New Jersey at the time. It's now on West Point's campus, but begin the journey there at the prep school. Come in as a 6'5", 11", 165-pound, 18-year-old, not knowing what I'm getting myself into, moving from Kentucky to New Jersey, a completely different cultural aspect of life, away from home. And 2 days into it, I call my dad and I tell him, this is not what I'm trying to do, just to play football. I'm coming home. And my dad says, son, I love you. I'll see you at Christmas. And he hung up the phone.
I was going to say, I bet that was a short conversation, just knowing
your dad. It was very short. Yep, it was. And obviously just having that support and really that guidance of, hey, man, you committed to this. This is something that you're gonna at least stick through and see, and then we'll reassess. But obviously without that backbone, I probably wouldn't have made it another day. So fight through some adversity, obviously, early on in the prep school career, and end up starting, winning that position. Had a great prep year. We would play a 10-game schedule and play other JUCOs, JVs around that part of the area. And at the end of my prep school year, heading into my plebe year, there was a staff change. So the staff that had recruited me was obviously no longer there, and we had a new staff coming in, and obviously triple option was still the plan moving forward. And they had saw what I'd done my prep school year, so came down and made a visit and essentially said I'd have an opportunity to compete if I still was willing to go. And so took the next year, went into my plebe year, and it was tough in a sense, just because you almost had to repeat exactly what you had gone through that prep year. While it's obviously in a different environment and a completely different location at that point, you know, just having that time to one, get indoctrinated to the life, but two, kind of feel like you've already paid the dues and having to redo it again. It was just an everyday battle, honestly, through that freshman year. But lo and behold, get through that summer and start training camp and end up winning the starting spot. And so I was fortunate enough to start at quarterback for 4 years during my journey at Army, and had the opportunity to play in a lot of different games and a lot of different environments, but none even compare or even match to the intensity and just the pageantry and the overall environment that the Army-Navy game has. And being fortunate enough to play and start in four of those, you kind of get caught up, or you kind of miss out on the external environment because you're so worried about doing your job and winning the game. But it's unlike any other rivalry out there, and it's America's game for a reason.
Sure. Now, and we'll touch on that a little bit more here in just a second. How many people went through the prep school with you and then made the transition to the academy? I mean, is that
Yeah,
a path a
so
lot of people take, or was it just a handful of
no,
you?
it's typically a handful. It all is really decided on your test scores, whether you can become a direct admit, or if you
Okay.
don't have the test scores, essentially they send you to the prep school. And in a lot of ways, for the sports programs at West Point, it's almost a year to redshirt because you don't have that ability at the academies. And so just from a development standpoint, physically, and then obviously mentally, just me being a homebody and born and raised in the same town, and then going six, seven states away, just getting used to that
Right.
was probably the most difficult thing. And then you have to worry about the military and getting adjusted to that whole lifestyle. So it was a 2 year overload. There is no doubt, and probably not a day went by that I didn't think about leaving.
Well, it all worked out pretty well for you. Like you said, a 4-year starter, first one in the history of modern football to do that at Army. I've got a few stats here written down, but only player in Army history with 2,000 yards rushing and passing, second in career touchdowns and points. He had 7 100-yard rushing games as a senior, and I think 17 touchdowns that year. You know, your name is sprinkled all over the record book. Is there any maybe one thing that jumps out that you're most proud of with all the stuff that you accomplished there? You know, specifically on the football field. I know you've already touched a lot on just the environment and how it helped you as a person and growing into the man that you've become, but specifically on the football field, is there something you're most proud
Yeah,
of?
I think above all, just the commitment and the resiliency and the toughness it took to one, play in that offense at the quarterback position, and then two, start for 4 years. There's just so much that can happen between a 4 year span, you know, and playing. Let's see, I think 40, 41 games throughout 4 years, and only missing three. I
And
think that was just something.
doing that in a system with the triple option where the quarterback can take a beating too. You're not just standing back
Yeah,
there in the pocket.
you're a glorified running back. So, I think somebody told me the other day I had over, I think, 600 carries, 700 carries in 4 years, you know. So again, I was a running back, but like I said, just one, having again the resiliency to fight through everything that we got to fight through as football players, but you know, more so quarterback operating that system in that environment, that spotlight, and coming out on top in the end, that's what I can really hang my hat on.
Well, definitely something to be proud of is an understatement there. So again, talking with Trent Steelman here, who spent 4 years playing quarterback in Army, 4 times starting in the Army Navy game. Again, something that hadn't been done, and I would guess may never be done again. But as you think about that game, obviously you already mentioned it's not a normal game. It's a step up in everything, intensity, preparation. The eyeballs that are on you, but maybe just give us a brief overview of the difference between that and a normal game weekend.
Well, it just starts with the whole week in general. To be Navy week, I mean, you have marches and parades and bonfires and all types of stuff going on. So just there's just a lot of festivities that happen pregame that you as a player got to be able to enjoy, but also understand that, you know, there's a bigger mission at hand. But when it came down to game time and the actual game atmosphere, I mean, you tried in a sense to block out what you can block out, but when you have presidents and 4-star generals and vice presidents and everybody else that matters in our government, they're watching and shaking hands. It's a surreal scene. again, it's something that I try to search back hard on, because those memories are kind of scarce in a sense, because you're so focused on your job and playing a football game and accomplishing something that's going to get you and your team's name etched into the record books and be known for forever. And so it's a game unlike itself, for the sole fact that both of these teams in their alma maters and their cheers with beat the other one, you know? And so when you reside on that 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for an entire year, then yeah, naturally there's going to be a little bit more to that game and a little bit more added pressure that comes with it. But at the end of the day, when you can just sit back and have a chance to revisit afterwards and take it all in, it's something special, because everybody there is a selfless human, and everybody there is going on to do something that only few choose to do, and that's protect us as Americans. And so when you have that involved with, in my opinion, the greatest sport on the face of the earth and everything that it represents, it all accumulates to something very, very special.
Yeah, and I one of the quotes that I share in the intro to the episode, but it always stuck with me, is and I believe is he said it in one of the games that you actually played in, but I think it was Gary Danielson basically said, you know, football is the easiest thing these guys do all week. So even with all the pressure that you're under, and like you said, four-star generals and presidents watching the game, it's still the easiest thing that you guys are doing all week, which I think people should not lose track of when they're watching. And you know, it's a game I want to get to at some point. I always wanted to try to get there where you were playing, but I was coaching college soccer at the time, and I was usually watching it on some type of meal break from recruiting, either in Raleigh or somewhere in Florida. But yeah, that, you know, the environment just seems so special. Is there, like you said, stuff happening all week? Is there maybe one thing that was your favorite non-football activity that you look forward to every year?
The send off that happens every year as we leave to travel. Typically for us, it was to Philadelphia. We went to Washington, D.C. to play 1 year. But they, from there, there's a group of cadets that take the game ball and they run from the starting point of West Point all the way to the middle of the field when the game starts. So just seeing, again, just somebody who carries that type of honor and tradition and willing to run a lot of miles to just deliver a football. It always puts things into perspective, and it's pretty cool.
And then maybe the last thing to touch on is just, you know, it is a very intense rivalry. Like you said, every day of the year, you're doing something thinking about winning that game, but obviously there's a lot of respect involved too. And
absolutely,
you guys are getting after each other on the field, I'm sure, with just as much intensity and trash talk as any other game. But afterwards, as soon as that, you know, last whistle blows, you guys are brothers, for lack of a better term. So maybe just speak to that a little bit, the respect involved in such an intense rivalry.
Yeah, I think the respect's so high just because you know what each other has to go through in order to get to that point, you know, to get to a Saturday, to get to the game day. No matter what any athlete, I think, or and even football player or academy football player will say, they're there to play college football. Now, as you progress through the 4 years, you learn and you become a leader. And at the end state, you understand what your future holds, but you also want some of that normalcy as a Division I player. And so, again, you understand the respect and have that common respect for one another, because you know what it takes and you know what it took to get to that point. And so I got a lot of good buddies that play for Navy. And again, we're all wired the same way and all there for the same cause and for the same mission. But yeah, on the field, obviously, you know what it is being a competitor and an athlete. But again, at the end of the game, you're all going to go serve the same purpose. So the respect is always going to be at the utmost high.
Well, Trent, I really appreciate you taking a few minutes here to share some of your experiences. I feel like we could probably do an hour and a half, but
we should.
I want to respect your time.
Next time.
And what I'm trying to do this time, or what I am doing, is kind of putting together perspectives. I've got you, I've got somebody, that played for Navy. I've got an administrator at Army to kind of talk about how it all comes together off the field. And then maybe I'm hoping to make this kind of a yearly tradition before this game every year. And then maybe next year start to take some deeper dives with some people. And I'll definitely keep you on that list. But before we get you out of here today, last thing we got to get is a prediction. I know who you're going to be picking to win, but do you have a score or anything in particular we should be looking for during the game?
It's always going to be a low scoring game. That's just the nature of it. Now, with Army's offense, quote unquote, going a little more spreadish, you could see some increase, but I'm going to go with a 24-14 Army over Navy. Go Army, beat Navy.
All right. We'll write it down and we'll look for that score. But Trent, again, thank you very much. I appreciate it. Definitely give the best to your family, and maybe next
you
time
do
we're
the same, brother.
Yeah, next time we're all in Bowling Green, maybe we'll run into each other.
Let's do it, man.
All right. Thanks, Trent.
I appreciate you having me, Chris. Have a good one, man.
Trent Steelman's story is a unique one, and so is the one of my next guest, who just so happens to hail from the same high school. Jamale Carothers played an integral role in one of Navy's best seasons in the modern era, and left his own mark on the Army-Navy rivalry. His work ethic and willingness to think outside of the box while working his way into the lineup were exactly what coaches look for. He was kind enough to share some of his experiences, including a wonderful description of why this game continues to be such a linchpin in an ever-changing sports landscape. All right, so I'm joined now by Jamale. Jamale, thank you for taking the time to chat a little bit about the Army-Navy game. I know we're coming off the holiday here, so first and foremost, how was the holiday and the time with your family?
Thank you, Chris. We had a great time. I spent a lot of time with my family, my new wife. It was a great time to be around all the kids in our family and eat some good food.
Good. Well, and yeah, congratulations, a newlywed and married to the former Bailey Sal, who is one of my favorite players that I've ever coached. So wish you guys the best, and you couldn't find a better one there to start your new life with. And I know she's proud of you. I know a lot of people are proud of you, just in general. But as far as we're concerned here, talking a little football. So, I'm trying to give people a little bit of insight, kind of the experience, what the Army Navy, experience is like. And you were there from 2018 through the 2020 season before coming back home to Western Kentucky. So maybe just start by giving us a little bit of background on your path and how you got to the Naval Academy in the first place.
Yeah, for sure. So I played at Bowling Green High School under Coach Kevin Wallace. And one day, it was my junior season, the spring of 2016, and he asked me what I'd be interested in, playing at a service academy because, a player before at our school, Trent Steelman, who a guy that I talked to before I made my decision, had went to Army. And I was like, of course, I'd be open to it. At that time, I only had a Marshall offer, so I was open to hearing any coach out and learning about a bunch of different institutions. So Coach Ashley Ingram, who's still with Navy, he came to our school and sat down with me and told me all the great things about Navy, which a lot of it, at 17, it was a great fit for me and what I wanted to do. And I had a great time there. So from there, I committed to Navy right before my senior season and went on to Naval Academy Prep School in Newport, Rhode Island. Okay. Later that year after I graduated high school, and then in 2018, June of 2018, I joined the Naval Academy in Annapolis, Maryland.
Okay, and what about that environment kind of drew you to it? Because it, for some people, it's kind of hit or miss. People are kind of really drawn to it, or it's a little much for them, and they're really pushed away from it. So what about the environment up there kind of drew you in into wanting to take part in that?
So when I took my visit there, it was a bunch of, you know, hardworking guys that were committed to their team and love routine. I knew being in the military, you know, you have a strict routine most of the time. And a lot of guys, they're hard workers. They do what they're told, and they're very respectful. So I thought that fit my mold, and it turned out it did. I met a lot of great friends there. You know, my best man in my wedding last month was one of my roommates there. So it worked out very well, and I'm happy to say I went there.
That's great, and found success on the field as well. You know, you had 20 starts and more of a fullback, right, than a true, you know, halfback or running back, and which is a little bit rare, I guess, with the academies. You see maybe a little more option, a little more of those formations, you know, than you might with other places. But you know, in 2019, you're the leading rusher, which is a little bit rare for a fullback. Some big games that year against Tulane and Houston with, you know, 154 yards, 188 yards against Houston. You guys won a bowl game. Just talk about kind of, you know, that season, maybe some of your highlights, but also just being a part of a team that goes 11-2 and wins a bowl game.
For sure. So that season was very rare, as you were speaking on. So I started off on the fifth on the depth chart. I moved from a slot back, which is more of a, you know, a running back type of option player, to fullback, and which I'm not a very big guy. I'm probably, you know, 5'9", and I was probably 190 at the time. So not a typical fullback that you see, a bruiser, you know, about 230. Mm-hmm. But the coaches thought my speed would help the team. You know, once I got through the hole, I could have some breakaway speed and score some touchdowns. So they moved me to that position. But like I said, I had to start from the bottom. And a couple guys went down, and I got my opportunity to start on special teams. From special teams, the coaches saw, you know, my effort and things like that, and it led to more opportunities to play fullback. Once I got that opportunity, I knew I had to seize it. And I already had situations like that in high school, so I was ready for it. And I just took it by the wings, along with, you know, my teammates helping me through that whole process. So it was a great time playing with quarterback Malcolm Perry, who's a spectacular player. You know, he broke the record for rushing yards that season. And then we had a great defense under Coach Newberry, who's the current head coach of Navy. And we had a great team. We had a great season. Like you said, we went 11-2, beat Kansas State in the Liberty Bowl. And we won the Commander-in-Chief Trophy, beating Air Force and Army that year as well.
That's right. That's great. And, I mean, your career – over 5 yards a carry. I think I've got it here, 19 touchdowns between rushing and receiving. And that's quite a bit of work in two seasons for any back. But like you said, especially for somebody who kind of playing a little bit out of position, but it's great that you go in and you talked about that hard work in the opening and that kind of, you know, you grab your chance and take it and never look back, which is wonderful. So Jamale, you know, we're moving into the Army Navy game. It's that time of year, and I think everybody understands it's a special environment. You know, a lot of people that weekend will probably be focused on conference championship games, but the Army Navy game is the one for me with all the history and pageantry. So maybe just talk a little bit in general the difference of that week. Is there any difference in preparation? I know everybody says one game at a time, but it's got to be a little different. But the difference in preparation and some of the, like I said, pageantry that goes along with that game.
Oh, for sure. So there's a bunch of things going on. It's kind of hard to stay focused if you think about it. But throughout the season, we would have beat Army periods in our practices where we would just focus on Army. And as you know, Army and Navy, it's a huge game, and both teams, they worked their whole year to win that game. So on our weights in our weight room, they say beat Army. You know, the things we hit before we go out to the field, it says beat Army. So everything is in our program is kind of based on that. Obviously, we want to win other games, but we put a big amount of time on, you know, beating Army. So we'd have periods just focusing on Army's plays and what they're going to give us, even when we're playing other teams throughout the week. So when we get to that week, it's a tough week of practice. You know, we're putting in different schemes and things we haven't done all year because we know Army has been watching us very closely. And then also there's a bunch of pageantry, as you said. There's a prisoner exchange at the game where, you know, we have exchange students that have been at the other school for, you know, that semester. They get to come back home. There's also the company from the Naval Academy. They run the game ball to Philadelphia, where I played my game my sophomore year. They actually take turns holding the ball and alternating running down the road to Lincoln Financial Field. So there's a bunch of things going on. There's a big pep rally, as you would think. Just a lot of stuff going on, and you know our coaches do a very good job of keeping us reeled in and dialed in for the game.
Yeah, and you know it's a big rivalry, but I know there's got to be a lot of respect there too for the people on the other side. You know, hopefully there's a lot of respect for both sides from the general public and you know what the young men in that game stand for. But you know, is there much trash talk, or is it kind of like a normal game, or is it, you know, does it kind of, as soon as the game's over, it switches back to that respect, or how do you find that balance in an environment like that?
For sure. So there's definitely a lot of trash talk on the field, more than normal, because everybody just wants to learn that much more. You know, like I said, it's a year-round thing. It's a thing you think about all the time. So everybody wants to win. There's a lot of trash talk. But like I said, once that last whistle's blown, you know, we know that we're in this together, and we are all fighting for the country. So I've heard a quote from a lot of my coaches that talk about how cool this game is because everybody on the field is willing to die for everybody that's watching the game. So it's like, it's a really cool experience. At Lincoln Financial Field, my sophomore year, it's about 70,000 people there. It's a loud stadium, and it's just like, just to go out there and be able to take that all in, it was a great experience.
Yeah, that's quite a quote there. Everybody on the field is willing to die for everybody watching the game. I mean, the whole reason I wanted to do this episode is because of my respect for the game and the people out there. And the way you just said that is even another level beyond, you know, the way that most of us view it. And that's really powerful stuff there. So in 2019, like you said, you guys won the game on your way to a bowl game. I think you had 2 touchdowns in that one, right?
Yes, sir, I did.
Yeah, and then 2020, I know you guys didn't win that one, but that's kind of a unique experience. I know they're kind of moving the game around a little bit now. For a long time, it was just in Philadelphia. But that was one of the 2020 was one of the few ones played on one of the campuses because you guys played at West Point, right, during COVID?
We did, yeah. It was a COVID game, so it was initially going to be at Lincoln Financial Field again, but we had to move it to Army because theirs was on the base, and we didn't allow many outside spectators to come in just because of the rest of COVID. So that was different. I'd never been to Army before, and it was kind of like a home game for them. Unfortunately, we lost that game 15-0, but it was a cool experience as well. It was a little bit foggy. We came in, we had a great game plan. We just didn't get to execute it the way we wanted to.
Yeah. And what was that one like in the stands? I mean, was it just families? Did they let any cadets in and just space them out, or how sparse was the crowd?
All the cadets were there. Not a lot of families were there like the previous year, but there was still, you know, a bunch of media coverage and things like that, but not a lot of outside fans in the city.
Okay. Well, again, we've already touched on a lot of things here, but if you had to kind of pick one thing from that game or rivalry that stands out in your mind, first of all, could you even pick one thing? And if you can, what might it be?
Oh, for sure. So one of the pictures that that will be on the screen is me and my best man holding the Commander-in-Chief trophy after we won the game. So late in the end of the game in 2019, I took a hit, a hard hit, and was taken out of the game for a concussion protocol. But I was feeling pretty good. And we were winning the game. So after the game, me and him, we got the trophy. We actually got to walk it all the way back off the field back to the locker room to share with all our teammates. So that's a picture that I'll definitely have framed here shortly.
That's great. Yeah, the winning the game usually helps you bounce back from the injury a little faster.
For sure, definitely. My family was all there, and we got to go out to eat after and celebrate that moment with them as well. So it was good.
That's great. Well, Jamale, I really appreciate your time. Before we get you out of here, we got to get your prediction for this year. I think I know who you're going to pick to win the game. But do you have anything as far as a score or maybe a couple of things we should look for while the game's going on?
I will say my prediction for this year's game will be 20-17 Navy wins in Gillette Stadium.
Okay. All right. So you're picking a close one and an exciting one.
Yeah, for sure. I think both offenses will struggle at the beginning, but then they'll dial in and get some things going.
Okay. All right. Well, we'll look forward to the game. And like I said, I really appreciate you taking the time and, you know, appreciate you willing to put yourself in that environment. I know you were playing football. Like we said, there's a lot of other stuff that goes into it, and hopefully people appreciate that when we're watching the game. And hopefully you are enjoying a Navy victory at the end of the game on Saturday.
Thank you. I appreciate it, Chris.
All right. Thanks, Jamel. We've heard from two participants on the field, but Jamale Carothers, Trent Steelman, and others don't get to play on such a big stage unless countless people are putting in work behind the scenes. Tricia Brandenburg is the Executive Associate Athletics Director at Army and a member of the Army-Navy Steering Committee. Brandenburg is an experienced administrator at Ohio, Towson, and now Army. There's a lot that goes into any game before a single snap occurs on the field, especially something of this magnitude. Brandenburg gives us a peek behind the curtain. Tricia, welcome to the podcast. I appreciate you taking the time to chat with me here ahead of the latest version of the Army-Navy football game coming up here in a few days.
Well, thanks for having me. I'm excited about the game and excited to be here today.
So, you know, have been a college administrator for a while now, a college athletics administrator. You've been in various capacities at Ohio, at Towson, now at Army. Even been an interim athletic director for a while. So you've experienced a lot of stuff, and I know this game is special, but you're also Ivy League educated. So you graduated from Cornell. So I think the most pressing question here is, did you have any classes with Andy Bernard?
I did not, unfortunately. So, okay. Had the pleasure of at least his Twitter persona tweeting about the Cornell 2016 Sweet 16 run in basketball, which I think many of us felt might be the only time in our lifetime that that might happen. So it certainly was enjoyable seeing the Andy Bernard Twitter persona cheer on the Big Red basketball team when they made that run.
Sure. So give us a little bit of insight, just kind of your day-to-day happenings with your job at Army as the senior women's administrator, but then also kind of some secondary sport oversight with football.
Yeah, so I arrived at Army in August of 2022, so I've been here for about, you know, 16 months now. After a long time at Towson and other stops at Ohio and Northeastern and UMass, as you mentioned. And so my role here at Army, I serve as our lead sport administrator. And so I oversee all of our staff that oversees our coaches and then serve as a sport administrator myself, which includes secondary oversight for football, as well as I oversee our sports performance areas and compliance. And additionally, as part of my role, I serve on our Army-Navy steering committee that oversees the operation and execution of the Army-Navy game.
Yeah, and that's kind of the perspective that I want to dive into here because, you know, there's lots of events and it's interesting to me because I was an athlete and then I was a coach and now I'm an administrator at high school, which obviously is a different level, but just on the other side of events now and how they operate. And just want to get a little bit of comparison to exactly how big this event is from an operations standpoint and the logistics compared to, you know, a regular football game that you guys have.
Yeah, so it's massively different. It's on par with Super Bowls, in NFL playoff games in that capacity. We just had media day on Wednesday, and Jonathan Kraft from the Kraft Sports and Entertainment Group even said the ticket demand for this game is more than any AFC Championship game or even Taylor Swift concerts that they've hosted at Gillette in the past. And so, you know, the ticket demand is high. But there's a lot that goes into these games that are beyond, you know, your average football game. You know, the having the entire Corps of Cadets and the Brigade of Midshipmen and transporting them from our respective academies to the game, doing the march on, flyovers, the number of special guests and VIP guests and you know, political guests that we have and have to manage. You know, that kind of escalates the event planning piece of this beyond a normal football game. And it's part of what makes the pageantry and the tradition and the excitement of this game. It's what makes it special, being able to have this game on a standalone Saturday where we're the only college football game being played this year. College Game Day from ESPN is coming back, and they'll be broadcasting from outside Gillette Stadium in the morning prior to the game. And so, you know, there's a lot of things going on that go on around this game. You know, the Patriots and Craft Sports and Entertainment, you know, expanded fan fests around the game to be open on Thursday and Friday, as well as pregame on Saturday. So that's new and exciting. They're actually doing a Patriots are on the road on Thursday night. So they're doing a watch party from the Army Navy game fan fest area on Thursday night at Patriots Place. And so there's a lot of exciting things going on around the game this year.
Sure. And, you know, you just mentioned something that is obvious once you mention it, but, you know, I hadn't even thought about transporting all the cadets to watch the game. You know,
right.
You think about just a regular college football game and kind of fans are getting themselves there on their own and students are getting there on their own. But, that alone must be a massive undertaking. But, yeah, the game used to be played primarily in Philadelphia. Now it kind of hops around. So from an administrative standpoint, you can't always just go back to the set template for how it's going to work at a different site. So what kind of wrinkle does that throw into everything?
Yeah, and obviously Philadelphia has historically been the home of the Army-Navy game, but the Army-Navy game has been played in about 17 different stadiums. And so, you know, this isn't a unique, you know, opportunity or challenge this year, moving it to a new site. And but there are new wrinkles in terms of, you know, people get really familiar with stadiums that they've been to a lot. Both our staff and our fans in terms of what they're comfortable with. And this will be the first time at Gillette Stadium. So there's a lot new to those of us planning the event, but also folks that come to a game year in and year out. And so, you know, we've been fortunate to work with Craft Sports and Entertainment, and they've been completely first class in how they have managed this event and helped us understand their venue, but also, you know, so committed to the customer service piece of this and to the fans coming to their stadium. You know, they want to show off their stadium. You know, they want to host a great event, and Army Navy is important to them, is an important event for our country, but for them to host. But, you know, it's an opportunity for them to show off Gillette and Foxborough and Massachusetts and the greater New England area as part of this game and the history that surrounds that area. As it plays into the history of both the Army and the Navy.
Yeah. And you know, you mentioned the 17 different sites and some of those are kind of one-offs, but I was amazed when I look back how few times it's been played on one of the campuses. And most recently that was during the COVID year in 2020. But yeah, it's amazing to think not just how many places it's been played, but how few times it's actually been played on the campuses but gone to a neutral site instead. Is there anything, this is your second go around with it from the planning standpoint. Is there anything really quirky or any, you know, weird stories you've heard that you need to be, you know, kind of keep your eyes peeled, things to be aware of?
No, I mean, I think this is going to be an awesome, awesome day, awesome event. You know, Gillette and Kraft, the Kraft family are awesome hosts for this. And, you know, I think, you know, the benefit of being at a place like Gillette and having Patriots Place right off of that footprint and the access, you know, our fan groups, our alumni groups are able to, you know, access, you know, rent out restaurants and different venues that are right on site for the venue. And so, you know, I think it's just going to provide a kind of an awesome experience pregame, being able to have everyone on site in the different facilities that foster that community that's such a big part of this game.
So, I mean, the tickets are split, right? Split right down, pretty much right down the middle.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm sure.
So there's an Army sideline and a Navy sideline, and the cadets kind of sit in the end zone with the prep school students from both schools kind of sitting in between the brigade and the corps, and it makes for a great environment.
And every single cadet is allowed to attend.
Yeah, so they're required to attend. So every cadet, every midshipman. That's their place of duty for the day, and they get leave afterwards. But it's part of what's unique and special about the Army Navy game is that this game gets to be played in front of every single one of their classmates, cheering them on the football field. And so it's part of what makes this really, really special.
Again, chatting with Tricia Brandenburg, she's the Executive Associate Athletics Director. Senior women administrator at West Point at Army. Is there anything that you have worked before that is, I know you said it's kind of comparable to a Super Bowl or AFC championship game. Is there anything that you've worked before that compares to this?
Not at all. I mean, I was fortunate to attend two games as a college student with my roommate from college who had access to the game, but working it as well, I knew how special it was from the time I was able to attend when I was a college student. But there really is nothing like it. The tradition, the pageantry, the excitement, the rivalry, all of that just plays into a really exciting environment. There's a lot going on before the game, during the game, after the game. I think it's one of the most special things that we do around college football or around football in general. And I'm just, excited to be a part of it and proud and honored to be able to represent Army West Point in putting together this game.
And I shouldn't be because of what the institutions stand for and what the kids stand for. But all right, not kids, young men and women, but just, you always want a respectful rivalry, but this is to me the best example of that. They're trying to bash each other's brains in for 3 hours, but big picture, they're all really fighting for the same cause, which is that cause is for the people that are watching the game.
Right. And we say that all the time. There's, in my opinion, there's no more fierce a rivalry. If you walk around posts here, we've got Beat Navy on the roofs of buildings. They're on flower pots in front of people's homes. People, you'll walk into seven people wearing it on their shirts every day. It says Beat Navy. But our rivalry is fierce. We are going to compete with each other. We like that competition. I think it's what makes, being an Army special is being able to have a rivalry like Army Navy that's somewhat unique in today's NCAA environment, and to be able to play that rivalry and compete as tough as heck on the field. At the end of the day, we're going to stand shoulder to shoulder and we're going to sing alma maters. But after they commission and graduate, they're going to be standing shoulder to shoulder out in the force, defending our country and defending what it makes America what it is today.
Right. Now, it's very well said. Now, the administrations from the two schools, are you guys shoulder to shoulder in this, or like, is it split responsibilities, or do you kind of take turns? Like, I know where I work with our big rival in the football game, it's at a neutral site, but 1 year kind of we're in charge, the next year they're in charge. We kind of treat it like there's a home team each year. Is that the way it works, or do you guys kind of work together with everything?
It's both. So we do take turns. This is Navy's year as the home team. They take on the majority of the load, but as part of the Army-Navy Steering Committee, we've got three people on the Army-Navy Steering Committee. They've got three people. We meet and work collaboratively throughout the year and many years ahead for each game. We were just on a call with Washington yesterday and 2 weeks ago with Baltimore, looking ahead to the next couple Army Navy games. And those are things that we work on together. Each institution takes turns taking the lead and kind of the operation of the game itself, but there's so much involved in each of these games that, you know, that we've got to help organize and steer and coordinate with each other when you're moving 4,000 cadets and midshipmen a piece, you know, to one site. There's a lot of coordination that doesn't just rest on one school's, you know, hands each right. and every year. And so, you know, it's both a taking turns and a collaborative effort.
Okay. So again, talking with Tricia Brandenburg, and for any of you guys, you know, a lot of listeners in Louisville or the Kentucky Midwest region, she is married to James Brandenburg, who a lot of you guys yep. Might know from being a sportscaster in Bowling Green. And if you've gone to Western Kentucky University, and I know this is more of a personal thing, but I know I've kind of followed you guys over the last couple of years with some of your adventures to the Ryder Cup and different events. You guys have been kind of hopping around the country, experiencing some pretty cool things. What's the next big event personally on your all's radar?
Oh, goodness. Right now, Army, Navy, you know, it's okay. like that's all in focus. You know, we've got a gala Friday night and, you know, I'm going to be running around, you know, making sure everything's in place. And so, you know, and then kind of relaxing over the holidays. And then I think we come up for air and figure out what's next. But, okay. you know, I've certainly been blessed to have a partner that's willing to share in these experiences with me. And, you know, it's, you know, it makes life a lot of fun and we certainly enjoy being able to experience these things, but Army Navy's right up there with some of the best events that we've ever attended.
Sure. Well, I'm guessing with the PGA being at Valhalla this year, he might be trying to pull you back to Louisville for that.
Yeah, I think that's going to be a guy's trip. Unfortunately, I don't think I get to hop along on that trip, unfortunately. But yeah, okay. So I think he already has some plans in the works for that.
Gotcha. All right. Well, last thing before we get you out of here, what is your prediction for the game? Obviously, I know who you're going to pick to win, but do you have a score or anything specific we should look for during the game?
Yeah, I don't know if I have the score. I mean, this game, no matter kind of where the teams are in their seasons, how well they're doing, you know, it's a battle. You know, and I think, you know, I don't know how many years in a row it's been a one score game, but, you know, I'm at least hoping for Army's sake that it's a more than a one score game for my blood pressure and everybody else's. But, you know, I'm certainly looking forward to an Army win and being able to celebrate once again with our team and certainly with the CIC trophy on the line for us anyway, the opportunity for our men to win the CIC trophy back and bring it home where it belongs is certainly an exciting opportunity for us and we're looking forward to it.
Well, Tricia, I wish you the best of luck with all of the logistical part. And I know there's a lot of stress. Once kickoff starts, I know that's when you can kind of relax and let things kind of run its course with the officials being in charge of the game. But good luck to you these last few days preparing for it. And I really appreciate your time and joining me. This has been a really fun one for me to put together, and it's good to get the perspective kind of off the field that a lot of people, they show up to the game, they don't think about everything that goes into it. So thank you for your time and thank you for joining me.
Absolutely. Thanks, Chris. Go Army, beat Navy.
I want to again thank all three of my guests, Trent Steelman, Jamale Carothers, and Tricia Brandenburg, for their perspectives on one of the greatest rivalries and spectacles in all of sports. I hope you will take some time on Saturday, December 9th to watch at least part of this year's Army-Navy game. Even if you aren't a football fan, watch purely out of admiration for the young men involved on the field and the men and women from both academies that are cheering them on. I will finish by combining two of my favorite descriptions of this game, both of which were mentioned earlier in the episode. When you watch, remember that the game is actually the easiest thing that the players from both academies do all week. And remember that it's the only football game you'll watch where everyone on the field is willing to put their life on the line for you and everyone else watching them play. That's powerful to think about. As always, I appreciate you taking the time to listen. The entire Tin Man Podcast catalog is available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and most other outlets. You can follow us on X at the handle Tin Man Pod. Many episodes, including this one, are also available on YouTube, some with bonus pictures, music, and videos. You can also look for additional resources in the episode notes. Feel free to give us feedback or ideas for future episodes on any of the previously mentioned platforms or by emailing to tinmanpod@gmail.com. Enjoy the Army-Navy game this weekend. May God keep the participants safe and healthy. May He protect our troops at home and abroad. And may God bless the United States of America. I'm Chris Tinius. Thanks for listening to the Tin Man Podcast.